Good morning, everyone. Let's stand together. We're going to teach you a new song this morning.
I saw Satan fall like lightning, and I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. And I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. My praise belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death to life. This grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what He started. Our God will finish what He started. Right. This is my testimony from death to life. This grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, then you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. Try it. If I'm not dead, then you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, this is my testimony from death to life. Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'll testify. This is my testimony. This is my testimony from death to life. Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Come on, some praise.
Good morning and welcome to Hamilton Hills. My name is Matt. And in just a moment, we're going to continue our worship, but I want to share a word with you this morning. Paul wrote this in the book of Colossians, speaking about Jesus. And the next song that we sing, we're going to talk about Jesus alone and how great Jesus is. Paul wrote this. He said, He existed, speaking of Jesus, before anything else. And He holds all creation together. In my weakness and in our human nature, we can quickly think that everything's just falling apart. I don't know what kind of week you've had. I don't know what kind of year you've had, or I know what kind of 2020 we've all had. But God holds everything together through His Son, Jesus. He's a gift to you and to me. Our hope and our desire is that if you don't know him, that you'd have a relationship with Jesus. And that if you know him, you would grow in your relationship with Jesus. So as we sing these next couple of worship songs, let's think of this great thought that Jesus holds everything together. Let's pray. Father, God, thank you for your son. And as we worship you, God, we worship with our palms and our hands outstretched in total surrender because we know and we recognize that you are in control. So God, would you do something great? We come in expectation of it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, such an awesome thought to think about our God that we're all going to be singing to in heaven one day. But he's also here in this room, and we can sing and lift our voices and worship him here in this church. Would you do that today?
You are here. You're moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. And you are here. You're working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise king. My God, that is who you are. Cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are here. Touching every heart, I worship you, I worship you. You are here, you're healing every heart, I worship you, I worship you. For you are here, you're turning life around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, Lord. You're mending every heart. I worship you. Stop working, even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working.
Come on, church, we're going to declare this today. He never stops working. Let's sing it.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop. Thank you. yes, my God, that is who you are. 'Cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
God, as we have worshiped you, we recognize that no matter who we are, what we've done, you have made a way. So God, would you clear the way this morning in our hearts and in our minds? Would we prepare ourselves for what you're going to do? And God, would we ask that you would do it in us personally? In Jesus' name, amen. As you're seated, I want to welcome our guests this morning. If you are new to Hamilton Hills, or if you're joining us online and this is your very first time, thank you for being a part of our service. We hope you feel at home. We hope you feel welcome. We have a saying around here that life is messy, everyone is welcome, and anything is possible. And so if it's your first time, if you're here with us in person, we'd love for you to look in the seat back in front of you. There should be a connection card. If you would take that and fill it out anytime during the service, there's a back portion that talks about next steps in your Christian faith and in your journey. We would love to pray for you in anything that you are going through or in a next step that you want to take in your faith. If you're online, in the description, there is a connection card that you can also fill out. Every single one of these, by the way, that are turned in, we donate $10 to a local mission. So if you'll turn that in here in person by either dropping it in on the box, the wooden boxes at the exits, or giving it to anybody on our team. We also have a gift for you just for being a guest with us here this morning. We have a ministry that during the school year happens during the day. Many of us don't necessarily see it, but it's called our preschool. And so Lori Neal, our preschool director, is going to show us what we have going on recently.
Hello, church family. My name is Lori. I know that most of you already know me, but we wanted to take just a minute to introduce you to our weekday preschool. I know that many of you don't get to be here during the work week, and we wanted you to see what's happening in our children's area. Right now, it's about 9:15 on a Thursday morning, and it happens to be drop-off time. And so you'll see kids walking behind me. A lot of their parents are dropping the kids off, and they're about to start their school day. We have the opportunity to touch about 70 children's lives every single week on our campus, which is just incredible. And we have a great group of teachers. Some of them you already know because they attend Hamilton Hills Church, and some you don't because they attend other churches. But I will tell you that all of us come together with the same focus in mind, and that's to share the good news of Christ's love with each one of these children, whether it's through sensory activities or gym activities or phonics or counting, whatever it is, everything that we do is with a Christ-centered worldview. Our preschool program services children from 18 months, and this year we are actually opening for the first time a full-day kindergarten program. So if you are interested in joining our program or hearing more about a program, or you have friends or neighbors that are in need of a preschool program, we would love to have the opportunity to talk to you. If you go to our website, hamiltonhills.org, and click on the preschool tab, it'll take you to our new website. Or you can reach out to me directly at lneal@hamiltonhills.org. I believe with all of my heart, if children can grasp the fact that Christ loves them at this age and get that foundation into their hearts, it's something that they'll carry with them for the rest of their lives. It's not only vital to them and to their families, but to the world around us.
Many of our people on our team are actually here this morning. Can we give them a hand this morning? They're a great team, do an awesome job serving our next generation. That new website, by the way, you can get to it by going to hamiltonhills.org and the preschool tab, or you can go to HHKIDS, HHKIDS.org. That's our brand new website for our Hamilton Hills preschool. So that's awesome. Hey, we have been going through a sermon series the last several weeks called In This House. This is the very last week of the sermon series. Pastor Mark will be bringing the message this morning. We're super excited about that. So let's prepare our hearts as we hear from Pastor Mark this morning.
So can we get something out of the way right now? Can we just come to a church in unity to say that Tom Brady has won enough and to go Chiefs? Can we do that right now? Go Chiefs right now. Done with that train. Let's move on. I thought the Colts fans would really get a kick out of that. But tell us who you think is going to win. It's the Chiefs, or don't comment online. But I'm glad you're here. I'm glad all of you are here. We're ending a series today. My name is Mark, and I'm one of the pastors here. There was a boy who was 11 years old. He was in fifth grade. He had just lost his friend from an accidental death. He was a little confused and trying to figure it out at a young age, as you can imagine, just the tragedy and trauma in his life. From then, he was trying to try out for a sports team. Several months later, and his family could barely make ends meet, and there was holes in his shoes, and a man in his church noticed and bought him a pair of shoes so he could try out for a sports team. That man did started going to his games, got interested in this boy, and asked the boy if he wanted to come along with his kids, and they would visit on Saturdays. Church people that were shut in and elderly, and in the mornings they would visit, and then he would do something fun. He taught that boy even how to drive and a lot of things in life, and that boy became a teenager. Once again, that boy seemed to find himself kind of lost in life, very shy, not wanting to talk to people, felt like he was out of place, and he started to put his life into sports. That's what he was good at. And another man in the church noticed that while he was volunteering in the student ministry, that boy was always off to the side and not talking to very many people. And so he decided to take some interest with him. And he was a former NFL player for the Denver Broncos. He had just retired. And so he would take him to lunch and talk to him about life and try and encourage him with his life. And he helped that teenage boy kind of form a picture of God and who he is. That teenage boy then became a young adult as he was 19, and he had some health issues, and he had to quit playing sports, and another man came along, and he owned a construction company, and he hired that boy. He had made him his assistant, and he taught him about construction and administration and organization, and he would pour into that young man's life, and he would keep telling that young man that I believe that God's going to do something bigger than you can imagine with your life. That boy didn't believe it. One day, that boy, who was a young man, walked into the office, and when he got there, the man sat him down and said, I want you to do something for me. And when he told him that, he said, I have decided that I was going to take a whole year's salary, and I'm going to pay your salary to go work for a church because I believe you're called to be a pastor. Think about that story. That's my story. I'm that boy. I'm the boy who kind of struggled in life and had some things happen to him that never thought would be possible to happen in a short amount of time. Those men made a big impact on my life, and they not only made a big impact on my life, even so much that at our wedding, those three men, usually you have friends and younger people in weddings. At my wedding, my groomsmen were all senior citizens, it seemed. I try not to get emotional about that story. but it's hard. This boy had some tragic and hard things happen to his young life, and if it was not for these men who sought after him and pointed him to Jesus, there's no telling how his story would have ended. I'm a product of the local church. I've seen firsthand how it has impacted me when people connected to the house of God treated as the faith family it was intended to be. With all the church's flaws and shortcomings, imperfections, I was able to see just a little in how the Acts Church was supposed to work. God gave me a little window through these men who poured their life into mine. We've been reading and studying and breaking down Acts 2, 42 through 47 this whole series. Let me read it to you again. This picture right here, many theologians call it the generous church. It's really the workings of a giving church, a church that's so in tune with God that gives the expression of what God wanted the church to be. In Acts 2:42, it says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and signs were being performed through the apostles. Now all the believers were together and held all things in common. They sold their possessions and property and distributed the proceeds to all as any had need. Every day they devoted themselves to meeting together in the temple and broke bread from house to house. They ate their food with joyful, sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. Every day the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. We've broken these verses down over the last 5 weeks, read them to you, talked about the Acts church. In Acts chapter 1, we see the beginning of the church. In Acts 2, we see how they were disciples making disciples. And we see the beauty of the church. The beauty of the church when they come together as one. I'm aware of the church's flaws. People have been hurt in church. People have been let down in church. People have been discouraged by church. Church can be a place where people bring spirituality to their own agendas and play it out. Church can get stuck because people don't want to change and they get uncomfortable when methodology changes. People say things and behave in ways in church that you would never hear out in the community, out in the workplace. Church can be a place for bad people to hide and take advantage of others and the vulnerable. Church can be irrelevant to the culture and community in which they live. Church can also be a place of criticism and gossip. I cannot tell you the things that I've seen in church, and you would not believe the half of them. This all used to surprise me, but it doesn't anymore because I've come to realize that people are not perfect. And all of us do things we should not do. Life happens in church, and that can derail us from our mission, or issues in life can come upon us, and we can get so focused on the wrong things in church. But I believe still today, as I did growing up, church is a hospital for sinners, not a museum for saints. I love the church. I'm thankful my parents reared me in church and it was their priority. I'm thankful I didn't have a choice in going to church. I'm thankful that we leaned into our faith family, and I'm thankful we focused on the things that were the right things to focus on. And I'm here today, and I believe more than ever the church is not just an important part of someone's life, but it is vital to meet the spiritual needs to everyone's life. There's nothing like the church when everyone is giving and doing their part that's attached to the church. You see, the church is not an organization. The church is an organism created by God through Jesus Christ. And the foundation of the church is Jesus himself. They found themselves together and everyone was giving because of their focus at the church. I walked around our campus last Wednesday. Lori and I are teaching a marriage class, and there's about 40 people in it, and all of them are filing for divorce since they went to our class. That was a joke. That's really not happening. I sat in that class, and we're around tables, and I was looking at the people that are in that class. I thought to myself, do they realize how important they are? I walked over to the children's building and that area, and you can see in the big glass people rocking babies or teaching children God's word or chasing them around a table trying to get them to sit down. And I thought to myself, do those people realize how important they are? I walked over to the student area, and it's the loudest part of the campus. I watched the life in it. The kids for a night had a safe haven where they could come and not just learn about God's word, but they built community over there. I saw young couples, young married couples pouring into students. Faithfully come every Wednesday straight from work, and I thought to myself, to those young couples who volunteer know how important they are. I walk in our lobbies and see people with a smile and try and help a guest who just started coming to our church. And I ask myself, do they know how important they are? I think of shut-ins who are watching me online right now. Who pray constantly for people. And I ask myself, do they realize how important they are? I can't help but think, when I look at you, I see those three men. Who changed my life forever. I know what grace is because of those men. I know what love is. Normal men in their community who didn't have it all together, but they got it. They realized that the local church was not a weekend event, but it was a faith family to belong to. They realized that sometimes there's issues in their faith family, and I thank God that they didn't go find a new family, they stayed with the family. I thank God with all their flaws that they realized how important they were, not only to their immediate family, but to a young, lost boy who had no idea how life would turn out. Here's the interesting part about the story. The man who bought me the shoes, I found out years later, the very day he was buying me the shoes, he was shutting down his company and filing for bankruptcy because it failed. And he could barely make ends meet. I never knew that. I never knew every Saturday he was living paycheck to paycheck and he'd buy me a meal. A second man who was former NFL player, all I could see was NFL player. I did not know at the time when he would take his time and take me out that he was going through an awful divorce. He was losing his wife. But he never told me that. The man who gave me my first ministry job, who paid for it, I didn't know that he had a brother with addiction that had done some very awful things that he had to work through. You see, I wanted to point that out because we live in a day that's so polarizing. We live in a time when I believe the church doesn't need to retreat, but it needs to be in unity together like never before. I believe that we live in a day of despair for those who don't know Jesus. I believe we live in a day when people who go to church are confused by a weekend event or a relationship with Jesus. I believe we live in a day where the church has decided when COVID-19 is over, then I'll come back to the faith family. When all the chaos is gone and my life is even out, then I'll decide to step out on faith again in my faith family. And I'm so thankful to God that those three men didn't wait for their life not to be messy. I'm thankful to God this morning that those three men didn't wait. But here's what I thought of. They did not give out of their wealth. They gave out of their purpose. Think about that statement. As a Jesus follower, my purpose is to give. As a Jesus follower, my purpose is to be the hands and feet of Jesus. As a Jesus follower, my purpose is not to be happy. My purpose is to live joyful. And there's years when I'm happy, and there's years I live in sorrow, but I can ultimately look to God in His grace and know that He is with me. They didn't give out of their wealth. They gave out of their purpose. They got it. They got the Acts 2:42 model. They got what the early church got, and they really believed that they could not outgive God. My heart's heavy. If this is the only message you hear me speak, I just want you to know it's heavier than usual. Because when I think of the word church, in my mind are people. People with great potential. People who have an opportunity to be game changers. That we must start living out of the purpose of being a Jesus follower instead of waiting for the circumstances to be right in our life. In this passage of Scripture, I believe there are a couple key takeaways that help with this thought, everyone giving. They had open hearts. The three men that impacted my life forever and the early church had open hearts. In Acts 2, 44. It says, now all the believers were together and held all things in common. They had all things in common because their hearts were open to Jesus and the rest of the faith family. You see, where you put your heart at, everything else will follow. I'm afraid that we've presented a relationship with Jesus where he is there for us, but we don't have to turn our heart over to him. I'm afraid that we've given people this hope of this faith that doesn't cost us anything, but as you know, if you've been following Jesus for some time, intimacy with Jesus costs you something. Living for Jesus costs you something. It will cost you the rights of your heart. If you want to see him do stuff in supernatural ways, your heart must be turned over to him. If you want to see him use you to make a difference, it's less about coming to a weekend event and more about us giving our hearts to Jesus so that we can be in tune with what he wants with our life. You see, I've heard the phrase, everything in moderation. And I believe that to most of the time, but I don't believe there should be moderation when it comes to following Jesus. I believe in great extremism when it comes to following the Savior, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the beginning and the end. He is worthy to be praised, and he is worthy of my life, and he is worthy of me saying, I won't wait on the circumstance to be good, and I won't wait on things to be all right, but I will follow him no matter where he leads me, even in the midst of pain, because pain is part of the process when you turn your heart over to Jesus. He deserves it. He paid for it. When he has your heart, we will go wherever he tells us to, and we will push fear aside. I get emotional thinking about my family being in harm's way. When people come to my family, the house, and I know that I'm a pastor, and sometimes people get the picture that the pastor and his family are perfect. This time, you'd be right, we are. Kind of a little dysfunctional, like you. Don't look at me with that smirk like, yeah, that's right, you are too. Have you ever heard this statement? I can talk about my family, but if someone else does, they're going to have to deal with me. Even in the midst of sometime most of our dysfunction as a family, I would not want anything to be in harm's way, my family be in harm's way. In fact, I wouldn't think for a second to give my life for my family. Why? They have my heart. My children have my heart. My wife has my heart. Though we are not perfect, though we face things in life, I want to protect my family. I'm motivated to make ends meet, to give good things to my family. And I believe that is a small picture of how Jesus wants his relationship with us to be. Everyone giving in the faith family happens when we have open hearts. Matthew 6:21 says, "For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." How open is your heart to Jesus? Are you waiting to give when things are well, or are you sure you can do it? Or have you given your heart to Jesus with no exceptions? When Jesus has your heart, you'll love others. When Jesus has your heart, you'll be a reflection of him. When Jesus has our heart here at Hamilton Hills, that's when we most look like the Acts 2 church, when everyone is giving together. Why? Because our commonality is not on preferences. Our commonality is not on some program. Our commonality is on our foundation, is on Jesus Christ. And though we may be different, and though some of you may be Patriots fans, we can all enjoy the company together. Why? Because we have all given our hearts to Jesus. They had open hands. open hands. In Acts 2:45, it says, they sold their possessions and property and distributed the proceeds to all as any had need. They lived their life willing to give to others. Those three men in my life were willing to live a life with open hands, no matter what they were going through. We see this picture in Acts 2:45. It was obvious in the verse that they were attached to the house and they lived with open hands when it came to the needs of their faith family. They realized they were to be stewards of their life. I believe that in order to give so freely without strings attached of your time, your treasure, and your talents, you must have the mentality that it is not yours in the first place, but God's, and He made you a manager of it. James 1:17 reminds us that every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. We've been blessed by God. And the things that we've been blessed by God with, whether that is talent, whether that is money, our life in general, we should be giving to others, living with open hands. Open hands. When I walked around the campus the other day, I wanted to yell down a hallway in the children's area. I wanted to walk around just yelling these words, but I thought people would try and commit me to where I didn't want to be committed. I wanted to say, and I want to say to you, God created you for more. He created you for more than just you being successful. He created you for more than just you being happy. He created you for more than just you and your family. He created you for more. He created you in His image. He created you with your corny personality. He created you with your funny jokes. He created you with your not so funny jokes. He created you with your likes and dislikes. He created you in His image. And you're created for more than just existing. But you're created for living. He created you for His glory and a relationship with Him. He has given you what you have so that you can make Him known. He's given you your influence so you can make Him known. He's given you that job so you can make Him known. He's given you that heartache so you can make Him known. He may have derailed your life with COVID-19 in 2020, but He's doing it all with the purpose so that you can make Him known. The good times, the hard times, and the in-between, you exist for the glory of God, and He created you not to just exist without purpose, but He created you to fulfill the purpose that only you can fulfill, and you express it through the local church. Everyone giving. Everyone giving by living with open hands makes the difference. That's when a church really sees God at work. They had open homes. Open homes. I know we live in a different culture than Acts 2. Some of us would be scared going to your home. You may not want us to go to your home. I assure you that everybody in their home has that closet where they don't know what's in it and they're scared to open it. Probably a lot of dead bodies in there or something. But they open their homes. In Acts 2:46, it says, every day they devoted themselves to meeting together in the temple and broke bread from house to house. And what that is meaning there, I believe, is they took communion. They constantly reminded themselves that their commonality was on Jesus Christ, the founder of Christianity. So fellowship wasn't the key. Fellowship on the commonality was. putting their life in Christ first, then with each other. Centering our relationship on the gospel brings a unity that nothing else can. Centering our relationship on the gospel. You tell me a church that's not fulfilling the mission of the church and they've lost their focus on the foundation of being Jesus Christ. You tell me a church that's arguing and bickering and fighting, and I'll tell you a church that's not centering their relationships on Jesus Christ. You tell me someone who is offended, you tell me someone who's struggling, I will tell you no matter what their fault, someone else's fault, something going on in life, I don't know what it is, but I would tell you that we're not centering our relationships on the founder of Jesus Christ. Centering our relationships on the gospel brings unity that no one else can, nothing else can. When I look at you, that God brought me into a relationship with you, I look at that as the foundation being the gospel, and He has something for us in our relationship on mission. This is why down through the years, the church could make an impact on a community that no other organization was able to do. It wasn't about a great weekend service or a speaker, even though the speaker looks really good today. No one laughed. That's good or bad. I don't know. It wasn't about a program, but it was the fellowship of the faith family based off the mercy and grace of Jesus Christ. God did not intend for Christianity to be a do-it-yourself project. He intended it to be with the faith family. Unfortunately, we have lost that kind of fellowship over the years when we transition the church from being one of the activities we try and fit out on the weekend. There is nothing like church with open homes and fellowship with Jesus as its foundation. When that happens, all walls are capable of being torn down. You want to fight racism? Be a part of a faith family that centers their relationship on Jesus Christ. You want to fight for the marginalized? Realize your life has purpose greater than you. And that when you put your relationship founded on Jesus Christ with your brothers and sisters, we can help the marginalized. The poor, the needy, the sick, those whose life is really messy, things wrong in our society. When we choose to open our homes and open our lives, when we choose to make God first in every relationship, when that happens, the church starts looking like the church was supposed to be. Everyone giving will cause natural fellowship and enjoying each other's company off the praises of Jesus. Judgments pushed aside. Love reigns supreme. And that's when the church starts looking like the church and catching the attention of those that are not a part of the church. That's it. That's my message. The end of the sermon series that we've done for several years now in this house. Today, I've given you more of my heart than just the teaching. That through all every one of us has gone through this last year and even in this year, when everyone is giving in the faith family, we don't only make it through the tough times, we excel to the community and reach them in the tough times. I can stand here and tell you this morning, I can say that if that 11-year-old boy did not see the expression of Acts Church, his life would have turned out so differently. In this house, we need everyone. with all your imperfections, those watching online, all your imperfections and all the things that are messy in your life and the mistakes that you've made and the things that's happened, the local church needs everyone to put their eyes on Jesus. In this house, I'm challenging you that we can be that church. I've seen expressions of it here. We can be that church that is a church like the book of Acts and have a faith family that is meeting everyone's need because everyone is giving. And today I'm challenging you and I'm challenging me that we all have a lot going on. But I'm challenging you to resist the culture of the day and show the fruits of the Spirit, long-suffering, and show who Jesus is. You see, the church that keeps its focus on the grace of God through His Son, Jesus Christ, by everyone giving, when that happens, we see verse 47 happen. It comes true, and I'm praying for that revival. It says this, praising God and enjoying the favor of all people every day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. If you're watching our service for the first time online, or you're listening to it sometime this week, maybe you've never heard that you can know for sure you're on your way to heaven in a relationship with Jesus. We want to tell you that you can. Because we know for sure, not by our works, not by joining a religion, not by us being better or doing good deeds. We can know for sure we're on our way to heaven in a relationship with Jesus simply because we trusted in Him who gave His life and defeated death. That's what our commonality is, ladies and gentlemen. Our local church, the Big C Church. Jesus covers us all. And I say to you, if you're gripped by fear, it's time to choose faith. I say to you, if you have something against a brother or sister, it's time to repent. I say to you, if the enemy's got you thinking you don't matter, he is a liar. I say to you, student in this room, that you are a world changer and God has great plans for you. I say to you, young adult, I say to you, single person, I say to you, elderly, I say to you, if you're breathing God's air, you're not dead and God's not done, and He has greater plans for you just coming for a weekend event, and He has greater plans for this church than for us to just fellowship, but He has great plans for us to make a difference in our society because people see Jesus. Everyone engaged. Everyone growing. Everyone telling. Everyone going. Everyone giving. And when we focus less on us and we focus on Jesus, and we realize if we're part of the faith family, that means me, I'm everyone. Then, when we're in this mode in this house, the only way to explain what is happening are these two words. Only God. Only God could have put that marriage back together. Only God could have changed that person's life. Only God could heal that sick. Only God could help that student that's in trouble. Only God. And my friend, those are the two words I long for. For Hamilton Hills, for Christians, to be able to give a testimony that only God. So what do you say? Ending the series, the purpose of it is for us to live a life that we can explain it by only God. Would you stand to your feet with me and to those that are watching online? We did something last week you may not have been here for. It's a wall over here called One, and we talked about everyone going and someone that God has put in your path. And we did this a couple years ago, and we're doing it again. Many names are already on the wall. Maybe you've already done that. Maybe there's a neighbor. Maybe there's a child, a parent. Maybe online you're watching and say, there's someone on my heart. Put it in the comments or DM that name. Private message it. You know what I long for? I want us to, as we sing a song like we're about to sing, just worship Him freely. And remember that God loves us. And then remember that He has a purpose and He has a plan. And if everyone together would look to please Him and get close to Him, we can change some things through Him. I'm going to pray for us. Would you bow your heads? Before I do, maybe there's someone here this morning. You say, Pastor Mark, I want you to pray for me. Would you include me in this prayer? I do not know for sure I'm on my way to heaven in a relationship with Jesus. I want to know that. I'm not going to embarrass you, come back to you. I simply want to pray for you. Maybe you're online and you have that question and you want me to pray. They'll pray for you if you put that in the comments. You say, Pastor Mark, would you pray for me? Would you slip your hand up so I can see it, so I can pray for you? You say, I don't know for sure I'm in a relationship with Jesus, but I want to know. I don't see anyone's hand. And I pray that to be true, that you know for sure you're in a relationship with Jesus. Maybe you're here this morning with a heavy heart, or maybe life is going good. I don't know your situation, but you realize today that you were created for more. And it's time to be a part of a faith family and do your part. And for us to do life together in community, showing the world who Jesus is. You say, Pastor Mark, there's things in my life, struggles, there's concerns, but today I want to continue to give that over to Jesus and focus on what only I can do and have a life at the end where I can say only God. If you want me to include you in that prayer, would you lift your hand and let me pray for you? Anyone like that? All over the room, our faith family together. I'm going to pray. And after I pray, if you feel led to write on the wall someone's name, or you feel led to pray, or to make this an altar, or at your seat, or pray with your family, let's leave here knowing that we worshiped Him freely. We're ready for our assignment, and we want to see only God be able to do some things in our life. Jesus, I come to you right now. I thank you for those three men. I thank you for the impact they made on my life. It reminds me how important the church is. And I pray right now that maybe there's a man struggling with his existence. I pray for encouragement in their life. I pray, Spirit of God, that you would move in their heart and they would feel led to impact someone's life like mine. I pray that our students experience this kind of church. I pray that you would give us courage to follow you. I pray that you would give us courage to face things. I pray that you give us courage to repent, make things right. And I pray, dear Jesus, that we would show this confused world who you really are. Thank you for meeting with us today. You truly are that way maker. Would you sing it with the worship team? Just sing it. let God do something in your heart as you sing this song with Him.
Thank you.
you are, way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Isn't that awesome? Hey, for those of you that are online, I know you couldn't see, but we had about 10 or 15 people come up and write a name on the one board. If you would like for us to write the name on for you, if you'll put that either in a direct message or the first name of the person you'd like to put on the board in the comments. We'll do that this week. We did that last week as well. I feel led to do this before we dismiss. Can we pray over those names on the board? Father, God, for everyone listening, God, we just lift each name up to you. God, we pray that even right now, with your Spirit, would you move in like a wind over those people's lives? Would you show them your love for them? God, would you use us? Would you use our church? Would we be a reflection and a magnifying glass of Jesus to these people? Father, would you do something so supernatural that only you would get the credit for it? Would we see each one of not just these names, God, but these souls come into a relationship with you, because you are the only hope and you are the only thing that gives peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Before we dismiss, and I guess as we dismiss, I want to remind you that today is the Super Bowl, and God wants you to go for the Buccaneers, because Tom Brady needs Jesus, and so hopefully he'll see Jesus by you being a light. No, I'm just kidding. Yeah, get off the stage. Thank you for being here today. And next week is I Love My Church Sunday. It's February 14th, Valentine's Day. So don't miss next week. I promise you it's going to be awesome. It's going to be a special week. We'll see you back here next Sunday.